Good morning, all the students. We'll now move on to second lecture under this module 5. Can you see the presentation? How is the weather on your side? Is the connection good? It is too chill today because of cyclone in Chennai, right? That we have that effect here also. So are you okay with the connections? Can you hear me properly? Can you see the presentation?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Good. Good. Okay, in the last class we have seen how to evaluate the what are the basic steps to evaluate the hypothesis and how to estimate the hypothesis accuracy. Now, while estimating the hypothesis accuracy, we have considered two important measures, sample error and the true error. Sample error is represented by error S of the training examples. Error S of the hypothesis, and true error is represented as error D of H. Okay, so sample error, our objective should be that we should reduce the true error so that it matches with the sample error. Means we have to develop a machine learning model which is highly generalizable, which works well with training data, should also work well with the unseen data, so that on the training examples, if the sample error is say 5%, even the true error with the unseen data also should be around that 5%. There should not be much difference between sample error and the true error. In that case, we say that our machine learning model is highly generalizable. It is performing with good accuracy, right? This is how we understood how to estimate the performance of, how to estimate the hypothesis accuracy. In today's class, before going into depth of how to evaluate the hypothesis in detail, we'll see the basics of sampling theory. Basics of sampling theory is very much important for you to understand what are the underlying concepts, how to summarize the results of machine learning model. Because machine learning models will give lots of details like R square measure, F statistic, standard deviation, quotients, then you will get T error, T value, T critical value, Z value, lots of such terms you come across when you try to summarize the model's performance. Now, how to interpret them? Okay, these measures are greater than this particular threshold, so I select this machine learning model. These measures are lesser than the threshold, so this machine learning model is not performing well. Up to that extent, anybody can analyze. But to take a correct decision and select between the best performing models, you should understand what are these terms? Why do you actually, why the model generates these terms in the summary? How do you infer that that particular machine learning model is performing very well with the sample at hand? So you should know all these measures. You should not be confused when I talk about standard deviation, variance, mean, estimator, estimator model, binomial distribution, normal distribution. When I say all these, you should not be confused in what context I'm using those terms. For that, I wanted to make clear about all the basics of sampling theory that is related to statistical inference. Okay, now in this, under this concept, basics of sampling theory, we are going to study about error estimation and estimating binomial proportions and the binomial distribution, mean and variance, estimator, bias and variance, confidence intervals, and two-sided and one-sided bounds. They will help us to perform two-sided and one-sided tests. Okay, all these should be made clear. When you want to become a data scientist, you should know all these topics very well. Only then you will know what exactly you are doing and how you are developing an application in order to assist in taking decisions about based on some data set. Okay, and those decisions are very crucial, say in machine critical applications or in business. If you don't take a right decision, then it may spoil the good name of your organization, or it will cause some distrust, or it will make your application unreliable. So you have to take proper decisions, and to take those proper decisions, these statistical concepts are very much required. Okay, now we are going to see what is a random variable, what is probability distribution, expected value or mean of a sample, variance of a random variable, standard deviation of some variable, binomial distribution, normal distribution, central limit theorem, estimator, estimation bias, and what is the confidence interval. All these terms I'm going to elaborate for you by discussing different examples. Okay, now let us first see what is a random variable. Let's see the definition. A random variable can be viewed as the name of an experiment with a probabilistic outcome. Its value is the outcome of the experiment, right? That is called as a random variable. Say if you are tossing a coin, what would be the probable outcomes? Head or tail, right? So the probability of your outcome becoming head, or the probability of your outcome becoming the tail, each of them is 0.5 and 0.5, right? When you toss a coin, what is the chance of getting a head? 50%. What is the chance of getting a tail? 50%. Right, and in terms of probability, if you express it, is 0.5 and 0.5. Right, now in that case, you can't guess what would be the outcome when you are tossing the coin. Only when you see the coin with its face on, you can notice whether it is head or tail. Before tossing the coin, can you guess what would be the output with 100% confidence? No. Can you guess what would be the outcome of that toss? No. That is why it is called as random variable. In this case, X is called as the random variable. Why? Because it doesn't have, we can't say with 100% confidence what would be the output. If you take rolling a dice, it has 6 possible outcomes, right? Now in that case, probability of X equal to 1, probability of X equal to 2, and so on, you can take probability of X equal to 6, right? Each of them sharing this probability 1, which would be 1 by 6. Probability of X becoming 1 means when you roll a die, what is the probability of getting 1? Out of 6 outcomes, you're getting 1 outcome, that is 1 by 6. Again, what is the probability of getting 2 when you roll a die? Out of 6 outcomes, you want 1 outcome, that is 2. 2 on the top of the dice. So that is 1 outcome. You are expecting out of 6 outcomes. That is why it is 1 by 6. The probability is 1 by 6. Okay, or 10 divided by 6, you can express it in the 1 divided by 6, you can express it in the decimal format. Okay, that would be the probability of that particular variable. So it is called as random variable because you can't expect the outcome before the experiment. Okay, now read the definition, it will make some sense for you. A random variable can be viewed as the name of an experiment with a probabilistic outcome. You don't know what is the chance, probability. So it is associated with some probabilistic outcome. Its value is the outcome of the experiment. What is the random variable's value? It is the outcome of the experiment. In this case, head or tail. In this case, 1 or 2 or 3 up to 6. Okay, Is it clear what is a random variable now? Now, when I am measuring heights of students in my class, is it a random variable? It is called a deterministic variable. Why? Because when I measure something, I get the measurement and I can see that. I can say, okay, when I'm measuring this, I can stick to this particular weight of the student. Okay, that is called as deterministic variable. Or say if I give you date of birth and ask you to calculate the age given a year. In that case, say I give the date of birth is 1995 and now it is 2020. So what is the age of that person? 25. You can easily calculate, right? That is, and you can calculate that with 100% confidence. In that case, we call it as deterministic variable. Again, if I give you joining date of an employee and what is his survey, what is his experience in that particular organization, you can easily calculate with 100% confidence. So that is called as deterministic variable. But in this random variable, or sometimes you call it as stochastic variable, because the word term is little complex, need not worry, it is same as random variable. It is another name for random variable. Random variable or stochastic variable. Stochastic variable or random variable is when you can't guess the output, when the output is random, when some probability is associated with the output, when some chance is associated with the output. In that case, you call it as stochastic variable or random variable. Got it, students? Is it clear? Okay, now next term is probability distribution. What is a probability distribution? A probability distribution for a random variable y, if you take a random variable y, you know now what is a random variable, right? So no more doubts. A probability distribution for a random variable y specifies the probability y equal to yi, any value y equal to yi, that y will take on the value yi for each possible value yi. It is something like Nityananda's speech, right? But you have to understand the definition properly. A probability distribution for a random variable y, you're taking y, say coin toss, you're performing an coin toss experiment. Now, for a random variable y, it specifies the probability that y equal to yi. Either y equal to head or y equal to tail. That y will take on the value yi. Yi is a set of values, head or tail in the coin toss experiment, right? For each possible value of yi, either h or t. Okay, now consider you're making two coin toss experiment. Two coin toss experiment means two times you toss the coin. Now, what are the possible outcomes here? You may get both heads. You may get a head and a tail. You may get a tail and a head, and both tails. Right? How many possible outcomes here? Total four possible outcomes. Okay, now probability distribution can be taken as a table. It can be represented as a table with recording the outcome. Say number of heads. We are interested in number of heads and its probability. Okay, now if zero number of heads you are expecting, what is the probability? Zero number of heads means total how many outcomes you have? Four. Out of that, what is the probability? It is 0.25. Out of four, if you want zero heads, then it is only this outcome, that is both being tail. Only one outcome you are interested in. Number of heads to be zero means when you perform an experiment of two coin tosses, if you want zero number of heads, In that case, this is having heads, this is having heads, this is having, sorry, this is having single head and this is having single head. So what is the only outcome you are interested in here? No heads at all. That is both tails. So out of four outcomes, one you are interested in. One outcome you are interested in. That is 1/4. So it is 0.25. Got it? Now, what is the probability of number of heads being 1? So how many such outcomes are there? 1, number of head being 1. This is 1 and this is 2. So 2 outcomes are there out of which you are expecting 1 outcome. So it is 0.50. Whenever you toss a coin, either head tail will appear or tail head will appear if you want number of heads to be 1. Okay, so you are interested in 2 possible outcomes here, but what would be the original outcome? Only 1. Possible outcomes are 2, but only 1 outcome when you toss 2 coins, so one after the other. So the probability here is 0.5. That is what you are mentioning here. Now, number of heads to be 2. Both the result of coin toss should be 2 heads. Should be heads. In that case, you are interested only in this outcome. This is not matching your requirement. This is not matching your requirement. This is not matching your requirement. Because you want 2 heads. Okay. So you are interested only in this outcome. Out of how many outcomes? 4 outcomes. So it is 1/4. So this becomes again 0.25. Now this is called the probability distribution of number of heads. Got it? Probability distribution of number of heads. Any doubt in this, students? Okay, now if you want probability distribution of y lesser than or equal to 1, what do you mean by that? What is the probability of an outcome y, say head, number of heads, lesser than or equal to 1? Means probability of 0 heads and probability of number of heads 1. Okay, so it can be written as probability of y equal to 0 plus probability of y equal to 1. Did you understand this? Probability of getting 1 or lesser than 1 heads. That can be written as probability of number of heads equal to 0 plus probability of number of heads equal to 1. What is y here? My random variable. What is the outcome of random variable here? I'm expecting number of heads. I'm interested in number of heads. I wanted to know the probability distribution of my random variable y when it is taking the values of heads. Okay, so it is probability of y less than or equal to 1. So I'm interested in 2 outcomes. One is probability of heads equal to 0 plus probability of heads equal to 1. So what will be your answer now? Probability of heads equal to 0, it is 0.25 plus probability of heads equal to 1, that is 0.50. So you will get the answer as 0.75. Okay. So this probability distribution can be understood as the probability of values it can take. Okay, here in number of heads, in 2 coin toss experiment, you have three outcomes you are interested in related to head. Number of head 0, number of head 1, number of head 2. So this is called as the probability distribution of the random variable y, where y turns out to be heads in 2 coin toss experiment. Got it? What is probability distribution? Okay, now the expected value. The expected value or mean of a random variable y is represented as e of y. And that is nothing but it is summation of all the random variable values multiplied by probability of probability distribution of that random variable. That symbol mu y or the sample of y is represented as e y. I'll make it more clear for you. When you read a definition, it will not be clear, but once you start understanding it in depth by referring to various examples and read the definition again, that will be more clear for you. Now, when I take a sample, say I take the marks of students in my class and take their average. In this college, I want to measure the performance of students, and I'm taking the sample from MCA department. Now I measure the average marks of those students. That is called as expected value or the mean of the sample. Got it? But when I take the average of all department students' marks, that is called as the population mean. When your sample mean is equal to the population mean, then we can say that this sample is a good representative sample because its mean is in line with the population mean. Sample's mean is in line with the population mean. Understood? So what is the expected value? Whenever you're taking a sample, you measure its mean, it is called as the expected value, or it is represented by E of Y, or simply mu Y. Mu is mean of that particular sample Y. And you should see that the sample mean should be equal to population, not should be equal to, if the sample means sample mean is equal to population mean, then you say that it is a representative sample. The bias related to the sample is very, very less. It is not deviating from the population mean. So it is a good sample. Okay. Now, what is variance? Whenever you talk about normal distribution, whenever you talk about linear regression, logistic regression, and as you go on with different machine learning models, you mainly keep repeating these terms, mean and variance. So you understood what is mean. Mean is average of the sample. Now what is variance? The variance of a random variable is, if you take the random variable as y, variance of y can be represented as mean of deviations of every sample point from the mean of the sample whole square, sum square. Okay, this is called as the variance. So how do you write mean in normal mathematical terms? Mu of y, how do you write it? How do you write this mu of y? Sum of all values, or we are taking y here, all values in a sample yi by n. This is your mean, right? Adding all the values y1, y2, y3, y4 in your sample, add them, divide by the number of sample points. That will give you the mean, right? Mean means average, represented by mu, right? Now, how do you find the variance? Each of the sample point difference or deviation from the mean, the average of all the sample points is mu. Now, each sample point's difference from that average square them, add them, and divide by the number of sample points. That will give you the variance of y, the distribution of y. If you have average in your hand and some variances are very high, say some points are having extreme values, then the variance value will be very high. Why? Because the sample points difference from the average is very much, very high. In that case, its square will be even higher, which will increase the value of variance, which indicates that variance, differences in the sample points is too much. Okay, that is how you measure variance of a random variable. It tells us about the dispersion or distribution of data around its mean, whether it is near to the mean or far away with the mean. If the variance is very high, then we say that the sample points are varying too much. Say one weight of the student is 50 kgs, another weight of the student is 100 kgs, another weight of the student is 180 kgs. In that case, the variance of that sample will be very high, because though the average, say 50 plus 80 plus 100, if you take, divided by 3. What will be the value? 180, 230 by 3. So you will get some value around 76. Okay? So this will be your average. Now, how to calculate the variance? 50 minus 76 whole square plus 80 minus 76 whole square. Each sample point's difference from the mean. 100 minus 76 whole square. Add them up, divide by the number of sample points, that is 3. This will give you the variance. Because the variance is too high, the difference between the weights is too high, the variance will be high. But if you have somewhere 50, 51, 52 weights like this, then the average will be 51. Now, when you calculate the variance, it will be very less. Did you notice now the difference between the weights is very less here, but the difference between the weights is too high here? So the variance of a random variable will characterize the width or dispersion of the distribution about its mean, around its mean. Okay? Now read this. The variance of a random variable, variance of y, is represented as expected value of the deviations square. Expected value means mean. That is what we are doing here, right? Divided by n. Expected value of each sample point's difference from the mean, square them up and calculate the mean. That is the estimated value. And that will show you the variance in the sample points. Now, what is standard deviation? This is much easier. You can just apply square root to the variance that is already calculated. That will give you the standard deviation. Standard deviation will explain you what is the spread in the data, what is the distribution of the data. Whether there is high spread in the data, like 50, 80, 100, or low spread in the data, like 50, 51, 52, when we take the weights of students, right? In 50, 51, 52 case, standard deviation will be less. But in 50, 80, 100 case, standard deviation will be high. Okay? So the standard deviation of y is square root of the variance. The symbol sigma y is used to represent the standard deviation of y. Okay, so whenever you see sigma of y or sigma of x, it tells us about the standard deviation of the sample points in the sample y or in the sample x, or values of the random variable y or values of the random variable x. Okay. Now, what is binomial distribution? Binomial distribution gives the probability of observing r heads in a series of n independent coin tosses if the probability of heads in a single toss is p. Okay, when you take the probability of head x taking the value of head in a single coin toss is probability of x equal to h, then the binomial distribution will give you the probability of observing r heads, say two heads in a series of n independent coin tosses, say three coin tosses in this case. Now, what is the probability of observing two heads in series of three coin tosses? Okay, that can be explained by the binomial distribution. Now, what is a normal distribution? Normal distribution is a bell-shaped probability distribution that covers many natural phenomena. Lots of phenomena you take. Say, as I said, weights of students in a class, very less number of students will have less weight or more weight. But most of the students' weight fall in this average range, right? When you take MCA classes, students' weight average, let it be 50. So very less number of students will have very less than 50 and very high than 50. In that case, we call this as normal distribution. Now, when you take social networks, in social networks, very few people will have very few connections and more number of connections. But most of the people will have average number of connections. Average number of means moderate number of connections, right? That is how we can understand about normal distribution. Now, if you take life expectancy in different countries, then very less number of countries will have very low life expectancy and very high expectancy. Most of the countries have average age, average life expectancy, right? Like that, most of the natural phenomena, most of the phenomena we take follow this normal distribution, which is like a inverted bell shape. Now, when we take a distribution like this and take the mean here, this is the mu, okay? Now, most of the values fall around this mean itself, and very less number of values fall away from the mean. Okay, this is called as normal distribution. Now, when I calculate the average weight of a class as 50, when I start taking each of the students' weight separately now to see what is the deviation. Now, most of the students will have 49, 48, 51, 48, 52, around this value only. But most of the very less number of students will have some weight like 30 or some extreme weight like 80, like that. Okay, so this is called as normal distribution. All the random variables' values tend to fall around a particular mean of the distribution. That is called as normal distribution. Now, what is central limit theorem? Central limit theorem is a theorem stating that the sum of a large number of independent identically distributed random variables approximately follows a normal distribution. Means it generally states that when you go on increasing the size of the sample, then the sample's mean and variance follow, the sample's mean follow a normal distribution. Okay, say if I take five students' weights, among them, one student is having very high weight. So my average will go towards that particular student's weight. But instead of 5, if I take 100 students' data, then this extreme weight students' data will be diluted in the average of 100 students. Say 80, 50, and 100, if you take only this much, what would be the average? We took it as around 76, right? 76. Now, 180, 230, yeah, 76. Now, if you take 100 students' data, I can't write all 100 students, but if you take the 100 students' data, you may get around average as 50. Now, you keep on increasing the sample. Now, the average weight of all those students will tend to fall around this 50 only. It will not be deviated because of some outliers. Okay, that is called as central limit theorem. As you go on increasing the sample, then the mean of that particular sample tend to follow a normal distribution. See this? The central limit theorem states that if you have a population with mean mu, if you have a population with mean average mu and standard deviation sigma and take sufficiently large random samples from the population with replacement, then the distribution of the leave this. If you are not understanding population with replacement and all, just leave this. Okay, population with replacement means whenever you pick something, you keep it back and pick another one. So you will have equal chances of picking the same sample point again. That is called as population with replacement. Okay, but at present, to understand this central limit theorem, this is not required. And take sufficiently large random samples from the population, then the distribution of the sample means will be approximately normally distributed. They follow a normal distribution. So whenever you take a large population's mean and standard deviation sigma and take sufficiently large random samples from this population, then the distribution of this sample mean will be approximately normally distributed. Why? Because you're considering more number of sample points, more and more number of sample points that almost resembles your population mean and that will almost resemble your population mean and variance. I'm repeating again, you have a population with mean mu and standard deviation sigma. Okay, now you're drawing a sample from that population. Now, if the sample is very low, it doesn't represent the population. So the mean of the sample and the population will vary. But if you go on increasing the size of the sample, say instead of 100, out of 1000 students, now you take 200, now you take 300, now you take 400, you keep increasing the sample size. As you go on increasing the sample size, this sample mean will follow a normal distribution and that sample mean would be approximately equal to the population mean also. Got it? This is called as central limit theorem. All the values will tend to be around this mean. Okay? That is why it is called as central limit theorem. As you go on increasing the sample, the average will tend to follow a normal distribution. Now, what is an estimator? An estimator is a random variable y, taking a random variable y, used to estimate some parameter p of an underlying population. Okay, now if you take probability of weights of a student falling around 50 in a class. This y is called as the estimator. Why? Because you are trying to calculate the mean of that particular class's students, whether it will fall around 50 or not. An estimator is a random variable y. You're taking a random variable y, used to estimate some parameter p, say the weights of the students of an underlying population, of a students from a larger college. I'm taking a particular class as sample from a college, from set of college students, which is sample, which is my population. Okay, see here, entire college students is the population. Now one department students I can take as sample. Now what is the sample's mean? That is called as estimator, and we'll see whether that estimator is equal to the population mean or not. We should take a representative sample so that the sample mean or the estimator of this sample will be equal to the population's mean. Okay, then we say that S is a representative sample, good sample what we have taken. Now what is the estimation bias? Now you get some sample mean as mu y and your population mean as say mu p. Now the difference between the sample mean and the population mean is called as estimation bias. Because you have a bias in your sampling, your estimation will be biased. If you have larger difference between your sample mean and the population mean, then we say that it is not a representative sample. Why? Because the sample is biased. It is not representing the entire population. Say from the college students, I have taken more girl students' data and less boy students' data. Then that sample is not a representative sample. Then I get some sample mean, which will differ largely from the population mean. Because my sample is biased, my estimation also will be biased. Did you understand? So the difference between the sample mean and the population mean will be called as estimation bias. Now read this definition. Estimation bias of Y as an estimator for P, say performance of the students I am measuring here, is the quantity E of Y, means the mean of the sample, minus P, the estimator of the population. Now an unbiased, that is the difference. Okay, now an unbiased estimator is one for which the bias is zero. Now there is no difference between sample mean and the population mean. We call it as unbiased estimator because the bias there is zero. There is no difference between sample mean and the population mean. Means I have taken representative sample. I have taken equal number of boys, equal number of girls, performed a study on the sample, and I am applying the study's inferences or conclusions for the whole college's data. Now when I see the sample's mean and when I see the total college students' performance mean, both are similar. In that case, my study is unbiased. My estimation is unbiased. So I call it as unbiased estimator. But if my sample is biased, then my sample mean will vary at large from the population mean. In that case, I say my estimation bias is large because my sample is not representative. Got it? This is called as estimation bias, and our objective should be to make this estimation bias as zero so that the sample is a good representation of the larger population, so that the conclusions you draw from your sample can be applicable to your larger population. The conclusions I draw about one department students from the college can be applied to all the college students' population. Okay, means I'm trying to make my model generalizable. My model is built on my department students' data, and I'm trying to make it generalize to college students' data. Now, when I see that there is no difference between these two, then my estimation is unbiased. Whatever I can conclude from my sample, I can also apply it to population, larger population. Okay, in that case, I can call it as unbiased estimate. Now, the last one, N% confidence interval. You have seen this, right? In the last class, if you have the Z value as 1.96, in that case, you take the confidence interval as 95%. Then if you take the confidence interval as 68%, then the critical value will be 1. What is that critical value Z? How is it calculated? It is the deviation of every sample point from the mean divided by the standard deviation. You will get the Z score. Now, when you see on internet Z score table, in that you can find out for 1.96 at 1.96 at 95% confidence interval means 0.95. What will be the probability? The table will be given easily. You just check for 1.9 around. What is the value for 0.95? That is 95% confidence interval. That will be the probability of the probability associated with that confidence interval. So an N% confidence interval estimate for the parameter P is an interval that includes P with probability 9n%, means if you take a probability distribution like this and you take 95% confidence interval, all this area, what is the probability of a parameter P falling in this particular range? That probability you can tell with the, you can state with 95% confidence interval. Now you take another distribution. Now you want, you are sure of only 65% confidence interval. In that case, we say that the probability of a parameter value falling within this range is only 65%. Okay, the confidence interval is 65%. Out of this, you can't guarantee its chance. Okay, in that case, we call it, we are assuring the probability of that parameter with 65% confidence interval. Means 65% of the time it may fall within this range, but 35% of the time it may fall outside this range. Okay? This I have explained you with respect to a machine learning model also. Now, when you take 95% confidence interval, then you are stating that your machine learning model will perform with 95% accuracy, and 5% of the time there may be error associated with it. Okay, you can understand in that way also. Is it clear? Now, what is confidence interval? Confidence interval is the area under the normal distribution curve around which all your data will probably fall. And 5% of the time only it may fall outside that area. Okay, so we are telling that the probability of a parameter falling within this range is you are having 95% confidence for that, that a parameter value falls within this range, and only 5% of the time it may fall outside the range. In this case, 65% of the time the parameter's value falls within this normal distribution range, 65%, and 35% it will fall outside this range. It has probability of falling outside this range. Okay, that is how you understand confidence interval estimate of parameter P, taking up a value under the normal distribution. In the next coming session, we'll see the basics of sampling theory. These are all the basic definitions what we have gone through. In the next class, we'll actually see how they are used in various measures. basics of sampling theory by error estimation and estimating binomial proportions and the binomial distribution. When we go forward with these calculations, I think the concepts will be more clear for you because we try to apply them in detail. Any doubts still here, students? Are the basic concepts clear? Okay, anybody, if you have a doubt, you can personally chat with me so that I can clarify their doubts. If at all you don't want to ask on this platform, you can ask me separately. I'll clarify your doubts regarding these statistical concepts. Okay, we'll meet in the next class.